everyone, I'm Trey Rich and welcome to The Buzz. On today's show, we have Topic, ATB, and A7S talk about their collaboration on the reimagined track for Your Love 9 PM. In our artist spotlight, we have Dina Renee, and then we talk to some of the final voice contestants that made it on their teams and preview the battle rounds. We're ready to get this party started, so roll that intro.
Aloha, my name is Ciana Pelekai. Let's get buzzed.
On the literal heels of his new music video release of Montero, Lil Nas X is going full Hellboy with the release of his Satan shoes. Lil Nas is putting out a limited release of Nike sneakers that are all about the Prince of Darkness and his kingdom, even the shoe design itself, which features a pentagram emblem sitting on the laces. It's got a Bible scripture on the side, Luke 10:18, which references Satan's banishment from heaven. There's also a 666 reference toward the back of the shoe with another number in front of it. Apparently, these shoes will contain one drop of human blood somewhere along the soles. It's unclear whose blood exactly is being used for this, but I know Kanye is somewhere saying, "And y'all called me crazy?" All right, let's start the show. First up, we have legendary German producer, DJ, songwriter ATB, who teamed up with Topic and A7S on his 1998 remake of 9 p.m. Till I Come. The newly reimagined track is called Your Love 9 PM. Working together in a German studio, ATB and Topic blended their musical styles to create the track along with A7S, who finalized the lyrics. Let's check out the super trio as they tell us all about it. So tell me, would you feel my love?
You know, in the end, I'm really happy that this collaboration was reality, because this was my dream collaboration, you know, when it comes to 9 PM. So I never thought that I want to touch 9 PM again, you know. I waited for it 20 years, and because I thought never touch anthem or a classic like it was. But last year I had a lot of time, the lockdown time, and I've been a lot in the studio. And I listened to this melody and I thought this melody is still so alive for me. It's still there. And I have to bring this melody to the new generation out there. That's what I thought. But to work on this track, you know, my idea was not to just to do a cover version or a remix. I wanted to do it from the scratch, like do it a full song. But I needed somebody to bring fresh vibes into it. This was really important for me. So I listened to a lot of stuff, and a very positive stuff in my ears was Topic and A7S with their productions, and especially Breaking Me was like, I listened to the song and I was like, this is how I can imagine this would be the sound for 9 PM these days. And so I thought about how to get in contact with them, and through a coincidence, a cameraman of mine also knew Topic, and he gave me the telephone number, and I called Topic and told him about my idea. And he was like, that's amazing, let's work on it. And one day later, we met in my studio and started working. And the creation process was really fast and exactly like I dreamed about. So it was perfect and nice working together with Topic and Alex A7S.
I think we never saw it in new, or for us it was just making something new, and we knew that we need to put this great melody somewhere, but from the start we never, like, yeah, we saw it as a new song basically. So I just freestyled a bunch of melodies, and then after that we kind of went back and forth together and decided like which direction to go.
Yeah, I mean, I know this song kind of since I know music, because it came out when I was 6 or 7. And I mean, it's such a dance classic. And it's like, I think it's one of the first dance tracks without vocals, which went number one on so many charts. And yeah, I was really, really happy when Andre called. And he also didn't do any remakes or covers of that song before. So it's very cool to be the first one to touch that classic again.
No, it's so hard for me to see this track, you know, to make a decision, but because I know this melody for such a long time. But when we worked on a track, I immediately noticed this is, it's getting into a new thing. And for me, it feels like a new song. That's the crazy thing, you know, I listened to the melody, but it feels like a new song. And I loved it so much. And it feels like we set it to zero again, and I can hear it again, you know, and this is amazing. So I loved the work we did from the first minute. And I remember when Alex sent the first vocals, I was so happy because it fits so good together. Because it's not easy to have this guitar and a good voice on it. And I don't like vocals just put on the record, you know, that you can hear that. It has to be one. And I feel the vocals and the music is one. It's glued together. And this is very important. That's what I like. Otherwise, I wouldn't have done it. You can make me let go. Forget about the world for a while. You might be a hello. I'm drowning in the blue of your eyes. Even if the love was hurting, I'll be your... I usually just freestyle. Like, if I'm lucky, I can freestyle like a one take. And then like sometimes, or most of the times actually, there's like, when I freestyle, there are words in the freestyle, so you can kind of follow a story, and then I write, I just finish it, because the story is kind of already there from the freestyle. I remember when you did the first things, you dropped it over, and you already had this Feel My Love, and you know, and it was like, I think we had already had this, and then you wrote the other things around it, and I really like that, yeah.
I think that's the coolest thing. It's like bringing something, you know, to a newer situation. I think we should do more songs like that. Topic, how has technology helped you with music? Because when that song was created, they had like 2-inch reels and 24-track consoles, and now you can do that same type of production in your bathroom and be just as powerful. So like, how has technology helped you guys, you know, make this even a stronger song? I guess even with the workflow and of course the finished product.
Yeah, I mean, especially with the workflow, we were making this song during a pandemic, and A7S is in Sweden, and when we made it, we couldn't travel at all. So it really helped that we had Zoom and FaceTime, so we could connect, and then Alex could just record the song at his house and just then send it over via email. I guess back then you had to ship it, like the real tapes and everything. So yeah, technology really helps us to connect during those times and to continue to create music.
The other side, I was really happy that we, Toby and I, was able to sit in a studio together, because it's I don't want to just work over digital, you know, ways. It was cool to sit together, to feel the vibes and all these things. I even if we have a good technology these days, I love it to work together man by man in the studio. That's amazing. Remember all the words that you said. Even if the love was hurting, I'll be yours. I'll be yours again.
How was 2020 on you guys as far as creativity? Because again, it was a stressful year. Some people, you know, didn't mind being, you know, locked in. Other people had started struggling. But for you, how was it creatively for you to, you know, to have to be quarantined versus like locking yourself in and creating a song?
I mean, it actually have been very creative. must say. Like, I've been doing tons of songs. Like, of course, it's been hard sometimes to get like that inspiration you get like just from traveling and writing with other people, or, you know, doing a gig with people and bringing that into the song. But yeah, it's been still been very creative for me.
Yeah, it's kind of the same as Alex just said. Like, you have so much more time because you're not touring and not traveling. So yeah, I spent a lot more time in the studio just producing stuff and also working on other projects where I probably wouldn't have time if I would be touring. But yeah, it's definitely weird that when you produce dance music, you always test it as a DJ and you always play it like right after you produce it. And I really missed this part because it's just so weird now for 1.5 years to not have played in front of people. I would definitely love to play again, play the hits that came out last year and also play the new stuff to see the reaction of the people.
Hey, you know, the funny thing is, you know, I've been on the road since 20 years and I loved touring so much, you know, I still miss it. But after 20 years, I remember a short time before the pandemic, I was like, I think I need 1 year or something like that, free time, you know, to get a little bit out of it, because the traveling thing is kind of hard sometimes, you know, with the jet lags and all this stuff. And suddenly we had the pandemic, and it was a good point for me because I got a baby last year. And so I had the good opportunity to see him grow, you know, 1 year. I wouldn't have this opportunity by, you know, traveling all the time. And I'm kind of happy about that. But after this long time, I really need to be back on stage. So for me, it's two hearts. I'm a producer, writer. On the other side, it's very important for me to present the song. So it was always coming together for me. I never could do just one thing. I just couldn't do one just music, or I just can't be just a DJ and other people would do my music. I need to have both. So I love to be in a studio and produce the tracks, and I already have in mind how can it be on stage then and how will people react. And then I love to be on stage and test this track and see the reactions, and I'm really satisfied when everybody is like I assumed it in the studio. So I have both things are the same important for me.
Yeah, everything is kind of in the maybe world right now regarding shows. But hopefully in a not so far away future we'll do shows also together, would be sick. But I'm also planning on releasing a new single that I will announce dates soon.
Yeah, it's the same. Like, it feels like everyone's seeing kind of a light at the end of the tunnel. And yeah. Like the first festival inquiries are coming for summer and for late summer. So yeah, I really hope that this will all happen. And other than that, yeah, it's also, there's a single lined up right now, which is coming out, I hope, before of the summer. And yeah, besides that, studio time and creating new music.
Your Love 9 PM is out now on all streaming platforms. Don't go away, we have pop singer Dina Renee in our artist spotlight. Dina Renee just released her new single, Can't Let You Go. It's a mix of pop and dance, and like many recording artists, she had a bit of a delay with the releases due to the pandemic. But with a little ingenuity and reinvention, she pivoted and not only dropped a catchy pop hit, but an awesome self-produced music video on top. Let's take a look. You loved me, but oh no, the way that wasn't right, that wasn't right.
My music actually started when I was about 3 or 4 years old. I was just really into music and I kind of taught myself how to play piano. I remember teaching myself how to play Twinkle Twinkle Little Star by ear on the piano. And then I was obsessed with Mariah Carey when I was about 3 or 4, and I just like wanted to be just like her. And so I kind of would watch my sister, who was 5 years older than me, sing, and she could sing like Mariah. So it was like, she was like my idol growing up. And that was kind of where it all started. and I'm really excited about it. It's basically more of like a dance track, I feel like, so I'm hoping in my music video I'll actually dance in it, so we'll see. I always write all of my songs, so it's like I feel like I'm gonna be happy with it because it's my melody that I'm coming up with. So as far as like production, it's pop. Like I've always just loved straight up like pop music. So the more dance tracks I have, I definitely tend to like those a lot too. So yeah. So since COVID, I started to actually use the money I had saved up to get my own recording equipment at my home. So now I can record at home instead of having to go to a studio. So I started working with different producers and people in London, people all over, just starting to write songs for different producers that way. So yeah, definitely made me finally get my own studio, which I don't think I would have done if it wasn't for COVID. So yeah, during this quarantine, because there is no touring and it's really hard for indie musicians to make money during this time, I turned my apartment into a photo shoot spot. So it's a place where, you know, different artists come, different influencers come to take photo shoots and film their music videos. And it looks like a Barbie house. So I call it the Hollywood Pastel Palace. And I'm really excited. It's been really cool to see people create. Obviously, it's very COVID friendly. Like, I make sure it's clean and everything. But yeah, it's definitely been a way for me to make money during this time. So I would love to design more spaces for sure, because I've always been really into interior design. And I'm into photography as well. So I love doing that. So I actually have my music video for What I'm Not Gonna Do. I directed and produced that one. And I filmed it at my place and also another Peer Space spot as well. So that's actually how I started doing Peer Space. Was I was like, well, I'm gonna film my music video there. Why don't I just paint my whole kitchen pink, you know? I would just tell young artists that, you know, if you have a vision for yourself and you, you know, really see that vision, don't believe that everyone around you has to see it too. Like when I was growing up, I felt like my family and my friends should understand that I want to be a pop singer. And I had this vision for myself, and also moving to Hollywood. I'm from Tennessee, so that just seemed impossible coming from a very like middle class family. So I would just tell them, you know, nothing is impossible. Like if you, you know, manifest your life and you have this vision, you can do it. And it's not until it's done that people are gonna see it. Everything is at Dina Renee. Mm-hmm. And I'm on YouTube, on Instagram, Twitter, and then on TikTok, it's Dream It Dina. Hi, my name is Dina Renee, and you've just been buzzed.
Can't Let You Go is out on all streaming platforms, and if you're a creator in the Los Angeles area, don't forget to check out the Hollywood Pastel Palace you can book on Peer Space. After the break, we have the final voice contestants that made it on their teams up next. Next week, The Voice will start its battle rounds, and this past Monday, the judges filled their teams with their final members. And we have some of them to talk about just making the cut. Let's take a look.
And now I beg to see you dance just one more time. I seek you every time. And now I beg to see you dance just one more time.
I drew for miles and miles and wild, and you go. I do so many times to say,
give it all. Cause I just wanna see how beautiful you are.
So, I actually auditioned like 5 years ago in high school. And I didn't make it on to the next part, but they gave me some really good advice on how to basically build my stage presence. So I like joined clubs, et cetera, et cetera. And then college was in the music sphere, but I didn't necessarily think I would do a singing competition again. And then the pandemic hit and I was posting a bunch of YouTube videos. And someone from the casting team basically just emailed me saying that they saw one of my YouTube videos and that I should audition for The Voice. So I sent in, they requested like 4 or 5 videos. I submitted those and now we're here.
I was just so ready to go out there and show people what I have. And a lot of excitement too. You know, that's a moment I've looked forward to for a long, long time. So of course I was nervous just because that's how your body reacts when you see all those lights and the cameras and the four coaches sitting there in their chairs. But I was just so ready to get out there and do my thing.
Well, for me, it was actually crazy because I was standing on the side of the stage. The doors were closed and they were like, oh, you know, we're going to interview you with Carson Daly for a bit. Just ask you a couple of questions. So I thought it was just an interview and then we would like take a break and then go on. He interviewed me and next thing you know, he's like, all right, the stage is yours. The door's open. I was like, I wasn't expecting that, you know, but I'm like, I mean, I was ready. You know, I was ready for it. But then, so I walked out, I got on stage. I was so nervous. I had all butterflies in my stomach. I got on stage, the lights got dark, it dimmed. I just had like a, you know, I inhaled, exhaled type of thing. I had a big breath. And once the song started, I guess because I had so much nerves, I eventually like blacked out. So I really don't remember how I did throughout my audition because I blacked out.
I thought there was like maybe 3 spots left. So I was like looking at how many people were gone. I was like, okay, well, if everyone goes on, there's not gonna be space for me to audition. So I'm just sitting there trying to be positive. And then they call my name. I'm like, oh my gosh. Okay. And I didn't know whose team was filled because I think all the judges had 1 spot left or something like that. So I didn't know if it was John, Nick, Blake, Kelly. I didn't know what the situation was. So hearing everyone say that I was the last spot, I did not think that that was, I had no idea. Very surprised.
Yeah, I think battles, they told us from day one, once we started the battles, this is probably the toughest thing you'll do the entire competition. And I think that's right because you nailed it right in the head. You know, you gotta blend with somebody else. And I kind of went in with the mindset of if we do both the best we can do, that's good for both of us. I didn't want to make my partner look bad, and I don't want to make him look bad. I don't want to outshine them necessarily. I just want to have a great performance for both of us because I think the better we both do, it serves us not only individually better, but it just makes music something that people can remember and enjoy. And you know, the best case scenario is you and your partner get stolen or saved, and that's what I wanted from the very beginning. I didn't want to destroy them or whatever. I wanted them to have a great performance and both of us make something that we can really be proud of.
With the battle process, it was very nerve-wracking. I would have to say that it was very challenging for me. I'm not used to singing with someone or having a duet and kind of like challenging with someone. This was my first time. So for me to step out of my comfort zone and try to really battle against someone has been, it was rough. However, it was a great experience, and you know, it's a learning experience. I learn things every day. And from there, once, you know, it airs and everything, I'm just gonna learn from my mistakes and move on forward.
Yeah, it's a beautiful process, but it's also, like you said, like you're basically competing with one another. But what I love about all the contestants, like we're all just so grateful to be here, that there's no weird, like I'm gonna outdo you. It's more of like, this is a song, let's sing it beautifully together. You have you shine where you shine, I'll shine where I shine, and the judges will do the picking. It's because I was expecting it to be more catty, but it's not at all. Like I love my duet partner. I think we're doing an amazing job kind of preparing the song and leaning on each other, especially when it comes to like runs and stuff like that. I think sometimes people feel like the more runs you do, the better the song is. But reality is, you don't need a bunch of runs. Sometimes people get lost in that. So like having honest conversations and trusting your partner has been key the whole time.
Aloha, my name is Ciana Pelekai.
Hi, my name is Ainae.
Hi, my name is Keegan, and you've just been buzzed.
That's all we have. Special thanks to Ciana Pelekai, Ainae Nielsen, and Keegan Ferrell of The Voice, Dina Renee, and ATB Topic and A7S. Don't forget to like us on Facebook, follow us on Twitter, and double tap us on Instagram, all at @buzz_access. Please don't forget to wear your mask, wash your hands, and don't be a dick to each other. And Lil Nas X, may the power of Christ compel you. I'm Trey Rich, love and light to you all.
You loved me, but oh no, the way that wasn't right, that wasn't right. For me, and it shows.
For more stories and extended clips, go to thebuzzallaccess.com. I'm Trey Rich, and you've just been buzzed.